Spoiler alert, not all DACs are created equal. Let's take a deep dive into DACs, how they're made, and the different kinds of DACs that are out there in the wild. If you haven't already, be sure to check out our other videos in the Facts on DAC series. If you're new to DACs, this is a great place to start. What they are, how they work, different types, uses, and more. We'll include a link in the description if you want to check out the entire series. Now, one thing I really wanted to get into when I started the Facts on DAC series is figuring out why there are different DAC types made differently with different components, technology, and more. Ring DACs, ladder DACs, FPGA, resistors, off-the-shelf chips, Burr Brown, R to R. It sounds complicated and technical, and well, it kind of is, but we're gonna take a look at all of these types today and make it easy to figure out just how they're different. Digital to analog converters can be created a number of different ways, and a lot of times brands adopt a technology based on how it configures with their design process and the overall sound they want to tune for their audio products. There are a lot of reasons why you'll find different technology in different brands, but it's all part of their audio circuit design process, how a DAC type fits into their product based on various factors like portability, power draw, and effect on battery life, and what kind of sound they are wanting to create for their product. Yeah, the way you design your DAC can affect the way your digital music sounds, but we'll get more into that in a bit. I think the best way to start talking about the different types of DACs out there is to feature a brand and how they adopt a specific technology for their products. So let's get to it. Let's start off with off-the-shelf chips. Estelle and Kern, the creator of high-end audiophile-grade music players, is one of our favorite brands here at Moon Audio. They do portable high-res audio extremely well. Estelle and Kern likes to use off-the-shelf chips for their audio circuit designs. These chips represent a perfect combination of small size for portability and power efficiency for extended battery life and high quality performance for audiophile grade sound. When we call them DAC chips in this case, they are just that, computer chips where all the digital to analog processing gets done. One chip that does it all. Estelle & Kern uses a variety of off-the-shelf chips in their music players and sometimes in various configurations, pairing chips in dual DAC, quad DAC, or even hexa-DAC circuit designs. This can improve the overall audio quality and the resolution of the audio on playback. Estelle & Kern designs their AN Norma product line of entry-level DAPs, most commonly with Cirrus Logic DAC chips. These are more affordable and extremely power-efficient converter chips. They provide outstanding clarity and detail in AK's music players, resulting in great battery life as well. Going up the ladder to Estelle & Kern's AN Futura line, you'll often find ESS DAC chips. ESS Sabre DACs are known for more detail, depth, and resolution than a lot of Cirrus Logic chips. You'll notice a definite bump in audio quality to be sure. ESS chips in general are great for more analytical listeners who like to pick up on every detail of the music. And we finally come to Estelle & Kern's AN Ultima line of premium flagship music players. AK likes to use AKM DAC chips in their premium offerings, resulting in more full-bodied musical presentations. This is a great option for those who love to get lost in the music. All products we carry here at Moon Audio that utilize chips all use reputable chip manufacturers, ESS, AKM, Burr Brown, and Cirrus Logic. They are highly recommended as audiophile-grade DACs and will provide leaps and bounds over your consumer-grade converter. I'll make a quick mention here of iFi Audio as well, which uses Burr Brown chipsets in their portable DACs across the board. iFi Audio is a great brand offering a lot of affordable DAC options for just about every listening and ergonomic scenario out there. Their Burr Brown DACs are implemented in a way that provides a perfect balance of efficiency for their devices and robust and full sound. They're more on the natural sounding side when compared to Estelle & Kern's more analytical signature. The way Estelle & Kern and iFi Audio design their products, the chips are not the only part of the equation when it comes to how a device will sound, but they certainly give an indicator of the sound characteristics and sound capabilities of that music player. The entire audio circuit from input to output is considered when determining the tuning and sound of the device when it's created. So the DAC chip should only be used as one of the larger pieces of the sound signature puzzle. More on that towards the end of the video. A newer kid on the block is ROM, spelled R-O-H-M. This DAC chip is utilized in the Cayenne flagship DAPs. When AKM's facilities were shut down due to a large-scale fire, ROM became a go-to as a replacement in many DACs. I find where this DAC excels is in the full expression of stringed instruments. It's sort of a combination of the sound of ESS and AKM chips. The flagship Cayenne N8 Mark II utilizes this chip, and it's a fantastic addition to the market. R2R or ladder DACs are just another way of doing conversion. In a ladder DAC, one current source is always working for one of the digital audio bits exclusively. Think of it this way, one current source will always be following what the first bit in the digital signal is doing, and so on, for as many current sources as are needed. As the current sources go on, the amount of energy they must generate gets smaller and smaller. If you look at this diagram of the process, it will resemble a ladder. Cayenne is a popular brand that implements ladder DACs in many of its devices, resulting in astounding audio quality at affordable prices. One of our favorite audiophile devices here at Moon Audio is the RU6 portable USB DAC from Cayenne. The RU6 implements an R2R ladder DAC for its conversion. The basic idea here is a matched pair of two resistors. The first is R, and the other is 2R, which has twice the value of R. To achieve 24-bit R2R decoding, you need 48 resistors for one channel, or 96 pieces of high-precision resistors for stereo. R2R is famous for its natural and realistic sound signature. When it comes to the sound of the DAC, ladder DACs and ring DACs tend to sound more analog because they're using resistors. They're using an analog signal path to do the digital to analog conversion. These are important aspects to think about when selecting a DAC or device because it will be more in line with your personal listening preferences. For people who want an analog sound that has a little more body to it, the R2R DAC would be a great option to consider. If you want a music player with R2R architecture, then take a look at the Estellenkern SE300. It's a great DAC that allows the user to listen to their music the way they want, with tons of sound customization features and premium sound quality. DCS is another brand here at Moon Audio that takes a very different approach to designing their digital to analog converters. They use what is known as a ring DAC for their high resolution desktop DACs, and we'll see just how DCS's approach aims to address issues with common ladder DAC design. Resistors, like all electronic components, have an element of error in their values. For resistors used in a ladder DAC, the current generated by that section of the DAC could be lower or higher than needed. This leads to distortion in ladder DACs. A key point here is that the ladder DAC removes the link between the original signal and the physical resistor value errors associated with specific sample values. DCS's proprietary ring DAC technology is at the center of their Lena audio system and standalone DAC. Instead of using off-the-shelf DAC chips, DCS builds its ring DACs from the ground up. One of the key advantages of the ring DAC is its upgradability via firmware updates. The ring DAC uses a network of FPGAs, or field programmable gate arrays, that are running proprietary DCS software that controls the digital to analog conversion process, as well as digital filtering. At first glance, the ring DAC may look like a ladder DAC. There is a latch and a resistor for each current source, and these current sources are fed to a summing bus. The main difference is that the ring DAC uses current sources of equal value. This is known as unitary weighted or thermometer coded DAC architecture. Furthermore, the ring DAC does not use the same current source for the same bit every time. The ring DAC is based around a set of latches, all which are turned on and off at high speeds to produce an equal amount of current. The FPGA, or field programmable gate array, on the ring DAC uses a sophisticated mapping algorithm to turn sources on and off in such a way that any component value errors are averaged out over time. Because any combination of current sources can be fired for any bit in the ring DAC, the error generated is unrelated to the audio signal. It is decorrelated. This means that any errors are randomized and converted to white noise. This approach reduces distortion or noise to minuscule levels and allows low-level details that are so important in our appreciation of music to shine through. Speaking of FPGA, let's talk about Chord Electronics. The thing that sets Chord DAX apart from the crowd is their proprietary FPGA, which is the major component of the quintessential Chord sound. The FPGA isn't the DAC itself, but rather allows the DAC to run very high performance oversampling filters. We call these taps, and Chord primarily measures their DAC performance by tap number. A normal off-the-shelf chip like ESS or Cirrus Logic only has a couple hundred taps at most. Chord's flagship Dave DAC and headphone amplifier, in comparison, has a whopping 164,000 taps. So what's the deal with taps? Essentially, these performance filters enable the DAC to more accurately track and reconstruct the original waveform of the audio. These are algorithms built by Chord's lead designer, Rob Watts, and they can or could be updated through firmware updates, resulting, in theory, and better performance without having to get a new device. Chord doesn't do this, but there are companies that do, like PS Audio and DCS mentioned in the previous section. The popular Mojo 2 DAC and headphone amp was a major upgrade over the original, with newly improved and updated FPGA code. The original Mojo had 38,912 taps, whereas the Mojo 2 has 40,960. More filter taps means closer to the original audio of the recording. And it all has to do with the modulation between frequency response and the noise level in the unit. As you increase the volume and the frequency response, the noise floor adjusts with that volume. The Mojo 2 has dramatically improved the coding to do this more efficiently and accurately. It also has better filtering, with 40 DSP cores for better transparency. And this is a larger influence on the sound quality than the increased number of taps. Essentially, we're talking about hardware versus software-based conversion. FPGA is like the software version, whereas an off-the-shelf chip is the hardware version. Again, just another way to do it. The digital to analog conversion stage is a critical point in your signal chain that directly affects the sound quality of your music. For all these products, we recommend pairing them with the Silver Dragon USB cable. Bad USB cables with faulty connectors, poor shielding, and bad geometries can lead to a myriad of issues like packet loss and jitter. Be sure to check out our recent video on USB cables to find out more about this. Your music deserves better than a stock cable. And at Moon Audio, we handcraft every one of our audio cables in our headquarters in Cary, North Carolina. So it's time to unleash the true potential of your audio. Be sure to check out Dragon USB audio cables for the best performance in digital transmission. There are a couple of things to keep in mind with different DAC technology. First, no DAC technology is perfect or better than the other. Sure, you'll have people out there who swear ring DACs are superior to ladder DACs. To that person, ring DACs might sound better. Because remember, we all hear differently. The second thing to reiterate here is that DACs are only a piece of the audio circuit puzzle. They do not indicate how the device will sound in totality. You have to consider other aspects like the analog output stage, the length of the circuit, and more. Things like balanced versus single-ended, transformers, resistors, op amps, and tube-based analog output stages can play a tremendous role in the coloration and the sound signature of a device, sometimes way more than the DAC itself. Before people started messing with FPGA, there were all kinds of different output stages on DACs. That was the thing to do at the time because, well, you were limited by what was available with off-the-shelf chips. No one had created their own true DAC implementation outside of those chips, so people played around with the output stage. Solid state, tube, or transformer, those are really the three primary output stages on a DAC. And you can get a lot of tonal variation from each. Is one DAC technology better than another? Well, when you're doing your own research, remember that everyone is right and everyone is wrong. There is no perfect answer and it's all subjective. Use your ears to determine what sounds best for you. Everyone hears differently. Don't use measurement graphs. except to get initial impressions. Things like higher bit depths, bit rates, sample rates, lossless formats, and more will make a much larger impact on the quality of your audio data or audio files. Typically speaking, standalone DACs or external DACs perform better than built-in DACs or mass-produced off-the-shelf chips. But making sure your DAC is high-res capable is just as important. One other very important piece of all this that we have not touched on, and we'll get more into it at a later time, is the topic of the analog output stage that comes after the D to A process. This can dramatically change the tonality of the DAC. While we can summarize certain DAC chips to have certain coloration, one thing a lot of folks are not looking at is this output stage. You can have a solid state output stage or a tube output stage. With tubes, you can dramatically change the sound with a tube roll. And let's not forget about replacing the entire output stage with a high quality output transformer. We used to do a mod to the brand Original on their CD players where we used Lundahl output transformers. Talk about a transformation in sound. If you want us to cover this or anything else on DACs in another video, drop your questions in the comments below. The digital to analog conversion stage is incredibly important in your hi-fi system, especially with the rise of digital music streaming, and everyone does it a little differently. Knowing a little bit more about how the technology works should allow you to look at the entire audio circuit with more clarity and ultimately help you figure out what kind of DAC you like or what kind of audio gear you want. If you like this video, be sure to give a thumbs up and remember to subscribe for more audiophile content just like this. If you have any questions, drop a comment, and as always, thanks for watching.